So good afternoon. I am truly grateful and blessed to be here with all of you today. And I want to thank JG and RJ for inviting me to be here at Sacramento Soul Talks. And I really want to thank you for giving me this platform to finally step into my authenticity. So yesterday I was reading the Daily Word, and I always read that every day. And this is an excerpt from it, and it was total divine time for me to read this. It said, I am an authentic divine expression. My certificate of spiritual authenticity was verified the moment I was born. There is nothing I need to do or be to gain God's approval or grace. The very source of my being is of God. I needed to receive that message yesterday. I have probably rehearsed this talk at least 35 times, stressing me out so much I have acne like I was back in high school. I have notes. I know that it's going to be a whole different talk. I have no doubt about that, but I will do my best to stay on point. So that message I just read has resonated with me over the years, but I've never owned it. And yesterday, I felt like I was really owning that. And I really believe that the encouragement from JG and RJ and my friends and now myself got me here today. I wanted to bail, I'm not gonna lie. I wanted to bail. And this is gonna come up with my debris, trust me, I'll tell you. So the theme, Renew the New, made me reflect on my life, knowing that divine order is truly always happening. But I knew it was time to start removing that debris that was keeping me from the path I incarnated to do. And that is, I am a minister. I am a speaker. I am an inspirer. And I am a woman doing the best that she can every day. So I'm totally off my message, but that's all good. Oh, well. So what makes me realize, though, is that I have got to start looking at that debris and take those tools I have been taught for many, many years and start actually using them. Because the good old saying is, for me, practice makes permanence, not perfection. There's nothing perfect out there for me. Permanence. Practice makes permanence. So it's going back to my debris. It's funny. I can meet strangers or people I haven't seen in forever, and they will come up to me and say, you may not remember this, but you said this to me a few years ago, and you changed, though your words changed my life. I couldn't receive that. Couldn't receive what they were telling me, and I would just, oh, thank you, and cower and walk away. Or maybe not cower and walk away, but whew, they saw my magnificent being of light. I could not see it. So, you know, I only have 15 minutes, so I won't go into all of my debris. Trust me, we would be here until order pizza. But, you know, here are a few things I've done in my life, and I know JG said that in my introduction, that truly I've never felt good enough or worthy enough to be doing it. I faked it really good because people seeing me on the outside thought I had my shit together. You're like, Jam and Joe can do anything. I'm learning that I can. But I owned a bar and restaurant back in the early 90s. It was a lesbian bar, and I lost my tail. And so at 32, I'm in a cardiologist's office, and he's like, what are you doing in here? And, you know, little failure going on right there. So my friend said, okay, what are you going to do next? And I said, well, I'm going to learn how to play golf and become a golf pro. And they're like, cool, And so I started taking lessons, and my girlfriend at the time was 15 years older than me, very well established, very well known, very good in her career. And one night she said to me, she goes, you know, I hear you telling people you're going to be a golf pro, but I don't really see you making the moves to doing that. And I realized, well, you know, I better get on that, better contact the LPGA, see what I need to do. And I realized as I look at that, I did that because I didn't want to embarrass her. I did it for her, not me. Because again, I didn't think I was good enough to do that. But I taught for 5 years until the next big test I was going to have to take, and I was scared. Who do I think I am that I can be doing this when these people who I've been working with have been playing golf since they were 5, and I was 32 when I started? So I quit. I didn't think I was a good enough instructor. I quit. Now, I made up a reason why I quit. I thought, well, work Saturday and make $100 teaching golf, or DJ a wedding and make $500. So I was like, I'm gonna make more money over here. But the truth was, I was scared. Yes, I taught anger management to domestic violence perpetrators. Love doing that. But again, this little monkey mind of mine said I wasn't good enough. I opened up a church in 2007 called Center for Inspiration and did that for a year and with some amazing people and quit that because I felt like, who am I to be trying to inspire other people? Because my premise of this was, I want to inspire other people to find the chief inside themselves and guide them to their path. And I said, how can I be doing that if I can't inspire myself and guide myself to my own path? So I quit. I'm an amateur photographer. I have people who for years have been wanting to buy my stuff. I don't see it that it's purchase worthy, but I'm getting better at that. Now, the one thing I can say I'm great at, if you need a DJ, I'm your gal. I know how to get people rocking and dancing. And it only took me 29 years to say that. So, I want to move back a year and a half ago when I made a decision to go back to therapy. And there was three main things I was going for. One, I had been the main caretaker for my mom at this point for almost 20 years. So there was obviously issues coming up around that for me. Two, I had a huge resentment with my business partner of 35 years because I was doing all the work and he was making all the money. And also that business is being taken over by the internet. So I was like, what am I going to do for a living? And then three, I wanted to date again. I had been single since my divorce 7 years prior. That's where 7 years I hadn't dated. And I was like, I want to see if I have my picker fixed. And so I thought, I should probably go check out, you know, with a therapist and see, you know, how I'm doing. So I purposely chose the day before my 53rd birthday to go see her, because I wanted to enter 53. So 20 minutes into my therapy session, she looks at me after I've said why I'm there, and she's like, did you have a surgery when you were an infant? I look at her, and I'm like, huh? I said, well, yeah, I was 5 days old and then 3 weeks old. In fact, at 3 weeks old, the doctors told my parents, Joanne's not going to make it, most likely. So the good Catholics that they were got the priest in, baptized me, read me my last rites, and who knows? Well, apparently they knew I had to talk here today. So I chose to stay. I just chose to stay. But what she said to me was, and this was such an aha moment for me, what she shared with me, she said, you know that back in those days, they didn't think infants were connected to their nervous system. They didn't think you could feel your nervous system. So when they operated on you, they didn't use anesthesia. They probably numbed the area that they cut open, but they didn't use anesthesia. Whew, I have God bumps right now. the debris of my life just started floating in and like starting to make sense. Like, this is why I'm all over the place, or I feel as if I'm all over the place. Like right now, I feel like I'm all over the place. So I'm working, and she gave me some tools that some resonated with me, some not, and I'm a work in progress on that. But that was a wow moment that explained a lot of things. But it didn't still explain the part of me that, what was it? Why don't I believe in myself? I am my worst enemy. It's this past year and a half, well, not quite year and a half. The truth is, when my mom, when she unexpectedly passed away last year, I have been on a roller coaster of emotions and debris. Caring for her, what made me realize as I was getting ready for this talk, and this has been such a gift, so thank you. Because I realized caring for her was my safety from dealing with my debris around me, around work, around my romantic relationships. But I've realized that her death gave me this scary yet glorious opportunity to step into my own magnificent self. So I am ready to take this journey, ready to get on this road. I want to put fear in the back seat. I believe that fear is good for me, but I want it in the back seat, not controlling me all the time. And I've come to realize that one of the reasons sometimes I can't receive when someone has told me, gosh, that wedding ceremony you did was absolutely beautiful, or I realize I'm a big four agreements person, and I don't know if you know of the four agreements. And I love the second agreement, don't take anything personally. What others say is not about me. So I have actually taken that. Most people think of that as a negative thing. I have actually taken that as a negative or positive thing because my ego, don't get me wrong, I love to hear that someone said, oh my God, you had that dance floor packed. We had a great time. And that's been my worry, my ego. I've always wanted to make sure my ego was in check. I didn't want to, you know, be all, oh, I'm Gemma Joe, watch out. I wanted to make sure that I was, that myself was centered. I didn't want to be self-centered. So what I've come to realize preparing for this talk is that sometimes I just have to sit in my debris. Sometimes I just have to sit in the pain and the depression. And I just have to keep breathing and letting go and letting God. So today I'm better at unpacking that debris of baggage, whatever we want to call it. I'm definitely better using my intuition at throwing out the debris that just no longer suits me. I do believe I have some debris, some shirts out there that are pretty hard stained that I have to use spray and wash on. But once they're clean, they're actually good for me to keep around. And then my self-awareness, as I become more self-aware, I notice that spot quicker. And so all I need is a Tide stick. It's before that. That stain gets really hard. It's, oh, there's a spot. So yesterday, this popped up, and so that's why I put it at the end. I was having lunch with a dear friend, and he and I were jawing back and forth about what was happening in our life and what we were doing. And I said, yeah, I'm speaking at Sacramento Soul Talks tomorrow. I don't know why I said yes. He laughed about, I said, my acne. I'm like, you know. And as we were talking about what my therapist had shared with me about the nervous system stuff, I had this huge realization that I never even thought of came up. I assume that when I came out of my mom, I was a happy camper. Here, look, world, here I am. But 5 days later, I had that surgery. So I can only assume that I was in a lot of pain. So as I've been resonating on this, I'm realizing that I've had a lot of happy moments in my life that ended in pain. So what message did I give myself at 5 days old that you get to be happy for a few days and then in pain? Now, I just came to that realization yesterday, so I have a lot of work to go on that. A lot of spray and wash on that one, a lot of scrubbing. But the bottom line is, I am so grateful of the gifts that God has given me and the people that I cross paths with, that I learn. So far today has just been absolutely a blessing. And I don't have any regrets that I wasn't able to own my magnificent self all these years. I've had moments, but I don't have any regrets because that's what I'm here for today. I like myself better today. I know that everything is truly in divine order and that I am, whew, and I get to be. I learned to put the whip down and accept that I am a work in progress. And my progress really depends on me, my thoughts and my actions. So, what debris is in your path? Thank you for your time. Namaste.